Mike Weston, the CEO of Macon Housing Authority. We've heard a lot about houses lately, affordable housing, houses being too expensive, houses not being readily available. But he can tell us what's going on in Macon and what kind of houses is our CEO of Macon Housing Authority, Mike. Mike, welcome back to our program.
Thank you very much, Ken. Very exciting comments.
Well, Mike, let's talk about the good things that you are doing to help with the affordable housing. Last time you were here on the drawing board, you had, I think, Tyndall hadn't opened yet because I was in the process of under construction. You had just broken ground out on North Fast Drive.
But tell us what happened there. So thank you very much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here as always. So, yes, last time I was here, we were just finishing up Tyndall. And so now that's completely done, all four phases.
The old Tyndall House.
The old Tyndall House. Yeah, it used to be 412 units. Now we built back about 60% of those units, 240-50 units, in four phases. And the total investment in that neighborhood was $40 million. And so it's all open now, and we have a waiting list for every single one of those four sites. One of them is a senior site, and then three, what we call multi-family. So all together, all done, terrific. And as you said, you know, last time I was here, we were just breaking ground on Northside. So that's called Northside Senior Village. And lo and behold, about 2 months ago, we cut the ribbon for that property. It's finished, 100% leased, and about 100 people on the waiting list. And
that's right near Northside and
right next to Ortho, Georgia, right there in North Main.
Now, what's the nice thing about that project I wrote by is that it's near great places.
Oh, yeah.
Grocery stores.
Yeah.
Stores.
Yeah. You're close to the highway. You're close to great shopping. All kinds of services. Ortho, Georgia right there, healthcare. And just a great place. And so when we started advertising for that property, just the outreach from the community was tremendous. And people, you know, really wanted to live in a place like that. So once construction was near completion, we started pre-leasing those units. And I think last month we ended up leasing the very last unit. And so it's 100% occupied. Just a beautiful property.
Now, is that income-based?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's income-based, so it's affordable housing. It is based on the Section 8 formula. So that means that the rental pay is based on my income. And so I pay a portion of my income to the manager, to the property, and then the rest of that comes from housing or the rental. And so that's a terrific property. So now, fast forward hopefully another 6 to 8 months from now, we'll break ground on another property in the
for seniors,
and that will be right behind the Lowe's on Peak Road. So not too far from 475.
You're good.
Have you stopped? Yeah, right across from Kroger, and you have Lowe's and shopping center behind it, and so that we'll break ground on that hopefully this year, and that's really exciting. And then the other one, I think we talked a little bit about it last time. The other one that's coming out of the ground as we speak is the one down at Walnut Street, so Danville and Macon. And that's called Central City Apartments. And so
right near the old Central City Apartments is called Green
Apartments. Yes, exactly. So right next to Daybreak, the Daybreak facility. And so, in fact, we partnered with the Call USA as partners to develop that land. And almost all the infrastructure, the sewer and the water and electrical, almost all that's done. And as soon as we get another week without rain, we can do some concrete and start building buildings on that property. That's multi-family, affordable. We refer to that as more of the workforce. And so, kind of the need downtown is I think everybody works in. There's a lot of people who work downtown in restaurants and bars and so on, but yet can't afford to live their lives. They're expensive. They're nice, but they're expensive. And so this idea is let's build a really nice property so that people who work here can live here. And that, again, was produced with tax credits in partnership with the Call USA. Sister Teresa and all those volunteers that did it. Just a wonderful partnership. So that's coming out of the ground as we speak. And we're really excited. And the other exciting thing is we've got plenty of them. So that's the new production. So the Housing Authority, we try to do two things. One, we try to produce new housing. And then the second thing we try to do is preserve what we've got. And so one of the ones I'm really excited about is Davis Homes on the East Side. Rodney Davis, of course, named after Rodney. And so that's preservation. So, of course, Davis Homes has been used in the early 70s. Now, as we speak, our contract is in there renovating the entire property. And in fact, I was in one of the units yesterday that was just finished and just tremendous. I mean, just beautiful. And so we're coming back and renovating Murphy Homes, Davis Homes, and then Mount Homes, which is over Pleasant Hill. So that's the preservation activity. We don't want to lose the units, and if we can preserve them, we will. And so that's what we do. We kind of look at what we've got, and should we preserve it and rehab it, or should we just go somewhere else and build something new? And we try to do both. So that's what's going on.
I love the good news. Yeah. They are these places that you mentioned, they're asking for food density, if you will, they're near that stuff.
Right.
But now you also have, you have these two properties out in South Macon, or Houston Avenue, Bowden Homes and Old Plains.
Old Plains and Old
Plains. They are old, they're in food deserts, like, no question, no question about it. What's the future of those two properties?
So that's a very, very good question. So as we look at our next 5 to 10 year plans, we've got to look at those properties and say, okay, do we reposition them? Do we build them with a major amount of money? Do a major rehab? Or do we tear them down? Kind of, the same thought process that we went through with Kennedy is the same process we'll go through with those properties. They're not quite as old as Tingle, but they're getting there. They're getting there. And, property over time, we try to do a good job of keeping the property there. But in time, every property is going to have to kind of reach a decision point. Do we tear it down or do we refurbish it? And so we'll be going through that thought process in the next couple of years for those properties. But you're right, they're in food deserts, and, good customers who are residents who live there, if they want to get good groceries, they've got to go quite a ways. And so that's a hardship sometimes, absolutely. So that's a process we'll be doing.
I'm going to put my two cents in the spirit work, and I was going to tear
it down. Okay.
They've been a long time. Yeah, they've been a long time. I think they're basically let's be clear. They provided shelter for people who really want to need a shelter. And even if you tear it down, you don't want to replace a place for those people. That's exactly right. Well, speaking of place for the people, then. Now, the section 8 roster, we have quite a few people eligible for that section 8 roster. How many do you normally have at any given time that you are authorized in bid?
Sure. That's a very good question. So, in making bid, we're authorized for about 3,600 units.
Well,
at any given time. At any given time, right? And so, put that in dollar terms, in making, that means about $21 to $22 million. Comes in, need a housing authority at you, and goes out to land boards, private landlords, the only unit you want to rent to, it's through the section 8 program. So there's a lot of people. Right now, as we speak, there's about 300 people. 300 people who have that voucher in their hand, they can't find it anywhere. And so, again, that speaks to this whole shortage of affordable housing. We mentioned down in Pennington, right, it's getting old. But they are providing shelter in a decent place to live if they want to run. But it's also a big shortage of affordable housing. And that's caused by two things. One, as a country, not just Macon, but everywhere, we've gotten behind on producing more affordable housing. So you combine that with the inflation that we are experiencing right now as a country, and rents are going up. So now, I don't have a lot of units, the rents are going up, and so it makes it that much more difficult for people with a voucher to find a place. And so I probably, get a call every day from somebody who has a voucher, and they're saying, Mike, I've got the voucher, I'm glad I got the voucher, but I can't find anywhere. They search and search, and it's hard to find. It really is. And so we are
how many people you say again?
About 300 right now.
So if an entrepreneur and a builder, he owns the land and can get not that we want to put all 300 in the same space, but theoretically, a person could build 300 units that would have their built-in ready shovel ready, if you will.
Rather share it. And so we're actively recruiting one of those to come onto the program. We've got about, 900 right now, which is in speed, in Macon 15. And many of those have been with the program for years and years and do very well, which is fine. If they do well, that means the residents do well, and everybody wins. And so, but we want to, and like you said, if I'm an entrepreneur and I want to make money and I want to do good at the same time, what a great program. And so this conversation is really the same all across Georgia, all across the country. It's just a really, really tough time right now for voucher holders. But that's, it's good for the economy to have those conditions.
Now, that's the people with vouchers in their home, but how many the people on the list?
Good question. So that's always a challenge, too. So at any given time, we open the list about every 3 to 4 years, and we try to open it for a short period of time to take 2,000 applications. Right now, we're going to open up at the end of March, this month, and we'll take probably about 2,000. And then we shut the list, and then we start working through those 2,000 households. Some jurisdictions.
So how many are on the list?
So right now, probably we're getting down to the last 200 or so.
200,
yeah.
On the list right now. And normally your list will consist of
2,000 or 3,000.
2,000 or 3,000,
right. But it's been closed since, I think, 2018, right before COVID.
So the need is there, the backlog is there. So if you open it up now, probably 3,000 or 4,000
people. But that is a lot of people. That is a lot of people. And so we do a lottery system, so I could be number one on the list, or I could be the last one on the list. Once we get everybody's name in the computer system, we have a lottery, and it ranks everybody, and then we start calling people and say, hey, look, your name has come up on the list, and so we need to get you in here so we can get you qualified for Section 8 for the voucher in your name. And that process we do, every 3 or 4 years. And that process is replicated throughout the United States. And every list, whether it's the Section 8 waiting list or just a property, those waiting lists are huge and they're growing by the day across this country. The other thing that we always look at is the properties that we own or the properties that private owners own that have a contract with them. All of their waiting lists are big too. And so oftentimes I find myself telling people, look, you're not on the Section 8 waiting list right now, it's closed, you still need housing. And so we keep a list of the housing authority of other properties that are subsidized, that not, they're maybe just not directly through us. And so,
such as, say, the deficit.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, we don't own the
deficit. All the seniors by the
final tile, yeah, and there's probably 17 or so like that in Macon. So we'll say, look, go to the deficit, you apply directly to that site. And all of those, some of them are older, like the 208 years old, and then some of them are newer, and in fact, Bonneville Tower is being renovated as we speak, but they all have waiting lists. And so, that just speaks to the need of affordable housing.
It speaks to the income of the economic situation of our community for that as well. It doesn't look good.
High poverty rate.
Yeah, but thank God that we have the housing authority that we provide just because people don't have shelters. $80 on the year. Now, the people who, we'll say there's 3,000 or 4,000 that's currently out there that would be on your list, much more if even closer.
Yeah.
They could very well be living in very specific.
Absolutely. So the good news about the Section 8 unit, I've talked about this a lot, is, and you brought attention to it before, is if I'm a private landlord, I can rent to anybody and I can be either a good landlord or be a bad landlord. If I'm a Section 8 landlord, my property is going to get inspected. And if something's wrong and it doesn't get fixed, then the mortgage staff can even say, look, there's something wrong. You either got to fix it or we're giving this person a new voucher. But if you're right, it's just not substandard. And you're right, there's a lot of substandard units out there. And I know code enforcement has been beefing up and they're doing a lot more. They're really active right now, which is a good thing. You can have someone living in substandard housing. We also know that a lot of people living in hotels. And so there's a lot of folks with kids who live in hotels And that's what that's going to be awful. And so we see a lot of that. And then the next step really is homelessness. And you see the whole challenge of homelessness all over the country, Macon Bridge no exception. It's a real challenge right now for people to find. If you can't find a good place, a friend, family, even substandard shelter, you're going to be homeless. And so we see a lot of that. And we try to, we do have a homeless presence at the Housing Authority, and we partner with several agencies. So if you go to that agency and you present yourself as homeless, and you stay at that shelter for a while, that shelter can provide us with a letter of recommendation. That letter comes over to us, and we say, okay, let's see if we can qualify this person for a voucher, and at least, you know, try to get them on the right track to find us something. And we've done that for years. And we've housed hundreds of people that way, who otherwise were homeless. And so that's a good system. The challenge with that is we're only one housing authority. You know, we're only so many vouchers out there. So it's a challenge.
Let's get back to the people that you're touched about the housing that you do control via electricity. We're not going to control via the electricity.
Right.
Do we check for lead paint? Do we check for lead pipes and runoff wells? We know a lot of children are exposed to lead, right? The old lead pipes. Is that part of the inspection?
Right. So on the paint it is. So I'll paint it.
What about the lead pipes that are on the
paint? We do not check for that. We do have the landlord certify the certification to best in our office for us free. The other thing we do is we have a mechanism where we report to the health department. So here's the local health department. They get a report from us, and they compare that with any child who's tested positive for EBS, who's under the age of 6 years old. And if that happens and it comes back to the S6E9 unit, then we'll automatically be back to the doctor for the S6E9. We don't see a lot of that, but occasionally we do.
But more importantly, with this new infrastructure bill, which is positive to get rid of, why don't we insist and get some of that money for landlords? There's a lot in the court to replumb land and travel house, but we know that the lead pipes present in the whole house. We know that these lead pipes are carrying lead right to the tap into children and into the brain. And we know that the devastating brain effects of lead. Why can't we have a program in place to be proactive and say, look, Mr. Landlord, if you have a Section 8 voucher, we'll help you get some of this infrastructure money that's here for you. Get rid of these debt. And get rid of these debt pipes.
Be done with it for what's wrong. And that's the best way to do it. And in fact, that is something that the industry is actually talking about. It's just that, I think, that was one of the big things that happened.
And that's in the triple. We have to get all guys from everywhere. So you can't, you know, the Water Authority, here again, I'm going to editorialize a little bit to hit them and get on my soapbox. But the Water Authority does a good job of getting, making sure that the pipes lead up to the meter,
right,
are lead free.
Right.
But the pipes from the meter into the
whole house is right.
Those would be full of lead.
Who knows? And so one thing we did is we, every single person who gets a voucher gets a pamphlet that outlines what to look for. You can buy very cheap but effective packs to put on your water pipe so that it purifies, like I said, to help reduce that risk. We don't see a lot of it, but you're right. It's a very good, really a very good topic that the industry needs to push with HUD to make those funds available. Because you're right, if I'm a landlord and I've got a couple of houses, you know, it'd be thousands and thousands of dollars to rehab those. So what could happen is if the Section 8 programs of the world forced all landlords to do that, but there was no money to do it, the landlord would simply say, okay, I'm not shopping with Section 8, I'll rent it to somebody else, and the lights did that. So that's, you know, that's a debate in Congress, but you're right, that money, there's money out there that just needs to be really directed into this particular program. I don't think that's a good thing.
Another thing about the Section 8, you say you have people with a lot of vouchers cannot find a home. What's the northern, the ceiling, if you will? I know it's probably no four, but what's the ceiling on a Section 8 voucher? How much do you need?
$1,000
a month?
$1,000
a month? Depends on the family size?
Right. So basically, that is based on what they call fair market rent. And so HUD will do a nationwide study.
Yeah.
And Macon did the county. So right now, new bedroom, roughly $1,000. The problem, the challenge has been those rents have gone faster than the HMR. And so all the authority all over the country is struggling with that as we speak, because we've got vouchers available. We've got people with vouchers in their hand, but they can't find their units because if I'm a landlord, if I can rent it for $2,000, the special aid will only pay me $1,000 when I rent it for $2,000. And of course, that's that person's all alone. And so that has a huge challenge all over the country right now, and I'm hoping and praying that it will come into balance, but it takes time. It's a cycle.
And Chris is just joining us for the speaking with Mike Austin, our guest here today, who is the CEO of the Macon Housing Authority. And he's discussing the stressors of the Macon Housing Authority, but also the challenges that we're having to house people who are less fortunate than that, and that's the affordable housing and things of that nature. But Mike, I commend you for getting for this first in poverty, if you will, and not just building houses in what has been here before low income areas. You spoke about Peak Road and of course out on North Side, which is that. How much pushback, if any, have you gotten from neighbors or other people saying we don't not in my back?
Yeah, NIMBYs, we call it. NIMBYism. Yeah, we do experience that from time to time. And it's out there. But I always tell people it's a myth. It's the biggest myth in the world. And the myth is, well, if you build affordable housing in the area, pick an area, well, it's gonna depress that market. It's gonna people. But the opposite happens. The opposite happens every time. And that is just like Oldsburg, just like Texas. Where do you start? Well, let's invest a whole bunch of money here and there. Every time it spreads, and now all of a sudden, you can't live over in the Oglethorpe area. You can't buy a house for less than $250,000. 15, 20 years ago, it wasn't the case. But, you know, we built capital, tore down Oglethorpe. And so, yeah, that is a myth. But to answer your question, yeah, sometimes we do get pushed back. And I have to get on my editorial and tell people, look, the studies have done it. Nationwide, you name it. Especially when you have a good management agent. You build it, you manage it correctly, and you just watch the investment spread. And, you know, we're going to see that at Central City. We're going to see that in Davis. We're putting $40 million of reinvestment into the Davis area. Those are going to be great places, and you're going to see activity, people wanting commercial, more houses. It takes time. But we do get pushback. Not as much as we used to in Macon did, but you know, the Housing Authority, we're the developer of affordable housing out of the state of Georgia. And sometimes when we build the smaller families, we see that pushback. But again, we just get on our editorial and we just point out the facts that look. If we don't build it, someone's going to. It's going to come because people need affordable housing. It's a myth that it attracts. It actually has to.
One thing that you do when you build a unit, I'm sure you make sure that it's accessible to public transportation.
Yes,
that's the most. I know you do that. But do you also transport around your kind of house? I go down that street every day. I know you don't in charge of the street.
But the street is private.
It is.
It's funny, you don't have anything to do with it. Unfortunately, I don't. But it's funny you say that, Jack, because just this morning, you know, like Mike Pulpit, who works for me, you know, we're just talking about this morning. And so, yes, we, in Kendall's case, we invested $40 million. Great property. So now, Felton and Plant and Nuff Farm, those three streets that surround that need to be repainted. And so that's a closer county roads. And so what I need to do is start pushing this guy at the county and say, look, We've done this. The contractors are gone. There's no more heavy equipment, all that kind of stuff. You can tear up the roads. That's all gone. Now people who live there need a good street to drive on. And so that, sometimes that becomes a challenge.
So you would think the power would be that the mayor and the commission would see that as an asset, and right. How we want to make sure that things are living here.
Yeah, right.
And the beautification, the streets, and street lights, and nice streets to drive on.
We'll be pushing it. We just thought about that this morning. So, because, you know, during construction, no one wants it. But now that it's completely done, completely occupied, you're right. Those three streets. Potholes, I mean, you know, they're old streets. They have a lot of use, so it's time to. And I was told that Felton is on the list to be done, but I just don't want
that street to be done.
So that's one of the guys, you go straight, and then you play left on Nussbaum, and stay on Nussbaum. The old concrete is open, so they need. And we have to drive every day, travel to work. That's how I can drive to work.
Well, Mike, let me thank you for being with us and thank you for what you do. And people should look down from people who must live in the public housing, should not look down on them if they have to have a sectional voucher. And neighborhoods shouldn't be ashamed or be afraid to have someone to move into their on their streets or have a sectional voucher because, being poor should not be a shame. And it's not a shame, it's not a crime. So we should reach out to all of our people to make sure that they've got the house and appreciate what you do.
Appreciate you very much.
Thank you. We're going to speak with Mike Austin, who is the CEO of the Macon Housing Authority, doing great work here in this city and this county to make sure that people are housed properly, that landlords are held to account when they have sectional vouchers, but to also make sure the people who are living in those landlord houses with sectional vouchers take care of those houses as well, so it's a two-way street. So we thank him again for what he's doing. We thank you all for being with us here this week on the Built for the Spotlight. We'll see you next week on your host, Jack Ellis.